weeks ago, Gert said to me, "Oh, perhaps we could have a small book launch," I think were his exact words. And I sort of thought at the time that it's highly unlikely that it will be small. However, it's certainly fantastic to have so many people who've shown an interest and to join us today. My name's Jenny Carter, and I'd like to welcome you here on behalf of the Centre for Research and Education and Social Inclusion here at the University of South Australia. And I'd like to start by just acknowledging that the land we meet on today is the traditional lands of the Kaurna people and pay my respects to elders past and present. We pay our respect to their connections to the land, sea and community. And I'd also like to acknowledge the First Peoples, the traditional owners and custodians of the country where each of you may be linking into from this afternoon, Adelaide time or morning or wherever you happen to be. And also perhaps to acknowledge the time where, you know, we've got people travelling around the world, being stuck in different places around the world. And the issue of mobility is certainly an interesting one in these times. This seminar is being recorded and uploaded for public view. So please, if you don't want your image or voice to be heard, please turn your camera off and make sure that you're muted. As I said, I'm a member of the Centre for Research and Education and Social Inclusion here at the University of South Australia. It's a research centre that focuses on contributing new knowledge about issues related to educational and social inclusion. And we've had a long relationship with Gert, and we've had the opportunity to have him come and visit us several times and work with us. And unfortunately, he was supposed to come last year and wasn't able to, and hopefully he might be able to in the future. But in the meantime, this is a really wonderful opportunity for us all to get together and listen to what he's got to say about his new book and perhaps have some conversation. Today we meet to celebrate this latest publication. Gert is a professor of public education in the Centre for Public Education and Pedagogy at Maynooth University, Ireland. And I understand you actually got to go there recently. Is that right, Gert? That's exciting. And he's also a professor of education theory and pedagogy at Moray House School of Education and Sport, the University of Edinburgh. And he also happens to be an adjunct member here as well at UniSA, which is wonderful. We're also joined today by three academic staff from our centre who are going to have asked some invited questions. So we've got Professor Sam Seller, who's just joined us, returned to us from England, where he's now a Dean of Research here at at UniSA, Dr. Alison Wrench, who I hope is here. Are you here, Alison? Oh, yes, I can see you. And also Rob Hattam. Professor Rob Hattam, and now Emeritus Professor Rob Hattam. And they'll be asking some questions for us. And then hopefully after that, we might have a little bit more time. I think it's common when introducing someone such as Gert to go through and list all their accomplishments, which often is the number of books they've written and the number of publications. That was a lot of counting for me if I was going to do it that way. But I also thought it was probably not the right approach considering the way that Gert's written about measurement and numbers and the impact of performativity on education in quite a few of his publications. But what I did do was I went back to the appendix. I don't know if you've read the appendix in his book, Obstinate Education, where he outlines the rich trajectories of his thinking and the purposes of his writing in the philosophy of education and education theory. If you haven't read it, I recommend doing it, because it provides some really interesting insights, not only into Gert's thinking, but also the ways in which some rich theoretical thinking actually happens and the kinds of moves and thought processes and instincts and how they all seem to work together in interesting ways. He reflects on the theoretical questions about the purposes of education and how education happens that he's pursued. He continues to provide a range of provocations to us about how we come to education and know about it, about learning and what he's termed learnification. And I see Stephen Ball's now talking about a dispositive of learnification, how we think about teaching, and more recently what he has termed the significant question for education, which is how can we be at home in the world? Which leads us now to his new publication, World-Centered Education, A View for the Present. So I'm delighted to invite Gert to spend some time introducing the book to us. So if Anna, you can do your thing. And thank you, Gert.
I think it's ready to be shared, Gert. Thank you.
Okay. Good. Yeah, I'll start with saying hello to everyone. It's when I was emailing with Jenny, I think 2 months ago, and I said, this book is out and maybe it's nice to share it with colleagues in Adelaide and do a little presentation. Then she said, okay, we can organize that. And then it was announced online and in our virtual world, then it spreads. So it's really nice to see so many people here this morning or this afternoon or this evening. What I will do is talk for about 20 minutes about the book, give an indication of what the book is about, why it's there, and then we hopefully have an opportunity for some conversation around the themes and the topics. It's a bit against my nature to launch a book because I don't really like to have attention on me, to have the attention on the work. But this may well be the last book I write in this series, so I thought let's give it a go. So I'm really grateful for hosting it and organizing it and for all of you to be here. I need to start with a couple of apologies. I think the book, even in paperback, is a bit too expensive. The font size is really tiny and the paper is really thin. That's welcome to the world of global capitalist publishing, I would say. It's great that there are still so many books published, the economic pressure they are under. There's even a hardback, and I figured out if you transfer the price of that into Dutch guilders, the book is exactly the same price as the amount I paid for my first car. But that was a while ago. A few preliminary remarks about sort of the position of the book. One thing I've been emphasizing in different contexts and circles is that I'm not a philosopher, but that I try to do educational theory. And it may look philosophically, when you come sort of to it from the outside, it may feel like philosophy of education when you work in the English-speaking world, but my roots are more in continental Europe and German-speaking traditions, where education has managed to be an academic discipline in its own right. And the main point for me is that although I use philosophical ideas as well, I'm not in discussion with philosophers, you can say, to score philosophical points. I try to be in conversation with educators and educational scholars about educational points. And even the question, what is an educational point, I think is part of the work I've been trying to do. The biggest gesture of the book is probably to push back against the instrumentalization of education, which happens in all kinds of ways, and I'll speak a bit about that, and to build up an argument for what I call the integrity of education. And that has something to do with the integrity of educational practice, that we should be very mindful that education is not just an instrument and that all kind of people can have agendas that they sort of push in the direction of education and say, solve this for us, solve inequality for us, solve social justice for us, solve citizenship for us, solve literacy for us. Of course, we see this happening all the time, but before you know it, we as educators are just in a position to solve all these problems, and we forget the integrity of our practice, and you could say that the things that we should be concerned about as well as educators. So this is one line you can find in the book, and probably also in other books that Jenny referred to. The other thing I try to do is to to say the scholarship around education therefore also needs to keep coming back to the question of its own integrity. People talk about educational research, educational science. I like the German word Wissenschaft, which is more, I think, inclusive and less technical than often the word science and research sort of indicate. And what I've done there is to say, be mindful, the study of education is not an applied field. That's probably my worry about philosophy of education or psychology of education, that you constantly turn to another discipline to get your intellectual resources, and then you look at education. I'm always trying to say, what are the intellectual resources that emerge and that are at home in education? So this is one big line, I think, in the book, but also in the work I've been doing over the years. What I just want to do is to give you a flavor of the book by going in some big steps through some of the main themes, and I'll link that to the titles of the chapters. I call them highlights. They're highlights for me, but you need to decide whether they're highlights for you as well. So the title, this idea of world-centered education, that's partly a rhetorical intervention, but I always think that language is really important, because with language we can also make shifts and maneuvers. And we probably all know that in education there is this ongoing pendulum that at some points in time focuses strongly on the curriculum and says education needs to be curriculum-centered. I think in the current age of measurement, that is still a strong idea there. And I see it in discussions emerging in several countries that say education should all be about knowledge, and that's a curriculum-centered approach. Then the pendulum can go to the other side and people say, no, it's about the child or the student, and that's the case for child-centered education. And I see that emerging again and again also in our time. I call it here the new romanticism, and we can go into that. Notions like play-based education, or to say education is there to let children develop all their talents. I think that is in a sense as one-sided as just pushing on content. And with world-centered education, I want to bring in another term to say we need both, but they need to be in a relationship. So of course we need children, of course we need content, but you can say the point of bringing the two together is something else. And here I put it by saying, what we do as educators is to equip the new generation for their life in and with the world, but also to encourage them to step into the world. This phrase, in and with the world, is one that I use a lot in the book. Maybe there is a bit too much in that phrase, but the world is really important as well in the argument, because, to put it very briefly, the world is real. The world is not a construction. The world is not a fantasy. The world is also not a shop where we just can walk in and grab what we want and then leave again without any consequences. The world is real. It has its own integrity, and that puts limits on what we can do with it and what we can want from it. And I think some of the big crises that we are encountering, the ecological crisis, the democratic crisis, I think they are manifestations of an attitude towards the world where you can say we have forgotten about the integrity of the world. And as a result of that, the social world, the natural world is collapsing under that. In my earlier book on the rediscovery of teaching, I used the phrase the egological crisis, that maybe we are still too much in the logic of the ego, but these are all big terms. So the world plays quite an important role in this argument, because you can say the point of education is to help the new generation to meet that reality and come into a relationship with it. Out of that, I argue, and I introduced the book by saying these are actually the two main ideas that I work with in the book, that for me, educational questions are fundamentally and ultimately existential questions. So there are all kinds of sub-questions that can contribute there. But at the end of the day, the point of all the educational work is to help, encourage, equip the new generation to exist in the world and lead their own life there well. The other thing I mentioned is that for me, education is first and foremost a verb, something we do. And that's important as well, because the word education can be used in all kinds of different ways. It's a bit of a vague word, and I think this says something about the sort of the lack of precision in the vocabulary around education in English. But for me, education, first of all, means to educate. It's the work of educators. That's the perspective I have. Therefore, the title of the first chapter is What Shall We Do With the Children? And for me, that is, in a sense, the first educational question. And it's a question with all kinds of layers in it, because who are these we, and who gives this we the right to do anything at all? Who are the children? What is this category of children? What do we do as educators with our own sort of childish desires? But somewhere here, where the sitting generation encounters the new generation and asks, okay, what is there for us to do? That's where education starts. In the second chapter, I use a phrase, and I saw that Christoph Teschers is there, who introduced me to this phrase from a German scholar whose name may come back to me. What kind of society does the school need? Which I think is a brilliant question, because it suddenly does something really interesting in the discussion about the relationship between school and society. I developed that by saying, in a sense, there is a double history of the school. On the one hand, you can say, yeah, the school is a function of and a function for society. The school has an important job to do for society. And there is a historical trajectory that makes that clear. But it's not the only history of the school. And I put another history next to it, this idea of the school as a kind of odd and very precious halfway house in between home. You leave home to go to school, but the school is not work. The school is not the real life on the street. So the other history of the school as this place and time for practicing or trying things out, I really love this one from Samuel Beckett. School where the new generation can try, fail, try again, not to become perfect, but to fail better. And I think there is something nice in that twist there, to say it's about wisdom, not perfection. What's very helpful is that when you go back to the Greek meaning of the word school, it actually means free time, leisure time. You can say precisely the time that has not yet been made functional by society. So there is something interesting in that very word education that keeps reminding us of this second history of the school. And then I connect this to interesting work, a book called The Impulse Society, that says when you look around at how we have organized society, the principle of instant gratification is everywhere, because it's possible to make a lot of money out of that. I always make the joke by saying, Apple doesn't sell mobile phones. What they sell is the desire for a new mobile phone. And that desire they give us for free. And then, of course, the money starts to flow. And the point I work towards in that chapter is to say this impulse society may actually no longer have the time for this time of the school. And that's quite a worry. Because I think that both histories need to be present in the school and they need to be kept in a balance. I then go to a chapter with the title The Parkes-Eichmann Paradox. I started out as a teacher of physics long ago, and of course physics is often seen as a really important field. And one thing that's interesting in 20th century physics is that there is a paradox. It's the Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen paradox. And I just was thinking at some point that I thought education deserves its own paradox. And then I started to read into the EPR paradox, and it turned out to be much more interesting and much more appropriate for education than I had anticipated, because the paradox is about the incompleteness of a particular theory about the physical reality. And that made me think maybe the prevailing way in which education is theorized and understood and spoken about also is incomplete. Now I do this in this presentation in really big steps, so the nuance is hopefully in the text. But the prevailing paradigm I characterize by saying it's a kind of biosocio-neurocultural paradigm. It's a mix of saying we are natural beings, but we are beings who generate culture, and then education is the cultivation of natural beings. And when you begin to look at a lot of educational theory, but also how particular disciplines say things about education, like neuroscience, like sociocultural theories, you begin to see that this is quite a prevailing paradigm. I did my PhD on the work of John Dewey, and I think this is also the central sort of way in which Dewey thinks about education. He calls his philosophy cultural naturalism, that you can already see this combination of culture and nature. And he talks about us human beings as acculturated organisms. And over time, I began to realize that there is something missing in that picture, and that's the incompleteness. And you can say Dewey is brilliant in explaining acculturation, how we sort of get culture inside ourselves. He's brilliant in explaining learning processes. He's brilliant in explaining intelligent adaptation. But there is something that I think Dewey's theory cannot account for, and that is the fact that acculturated organisms may turn around and say no. And this ability to say no, I think, is the unique human ability that must have a place in education, because it speaks to the fact that we're not just organisms that can adapt to environments, but that we are, you can say, human beings who exist with agency and freedom. And that's what I theorize in the chapter by saying there is therefore an existential moment that breaks through this biocultural order. And that existential moment is really important, because you can say when someone says no, they are suddenly there as free human beings and not as living organisms. So here you can begin to see that the existential question comes back. And what I try to figure out in this chapter is that I think that in many theories about education, this is oddly forgotten in some way. Now, this whole question of how we can exist as subjects of our own life and not just objects of all kinds of influences is not a new theme in my own work. I've used this word subjectification because I think it's a good word for it. But it's also an odd word. And it's difficult, you can say, in the English language to find a good vocabulary. But again, in German educational theory, there are better words for it. The word Erziehung, for example. And there is a really good phrase in the work of a German scholar, Dietrich Benner, who says, the work that we do here as educators in relation to the possibility for our students to exist as subjects, that is Aufforderung zur Selbsttätigkeit, which you can translate as sort of summoning or encouraging to self-action. And one thing I do in the book is to say, be very careful to summon someone into self-action is not to say to them, be yourself. And the world is full of everyone who just want to be themselves, but it's to say, be a self. And the question, be a self, the summoning to be a self, there for me, education has something to do with the question of human existence. Now we can talk about that in the most complicated theoretical ways you want, but it comes back to a very simple question. Hey, you there, where are you? That in a sense is the existential educational question. And then in the previous chapter, I write a lot about Rosa Parks and Adolf Eichmann, because what's really interesting is that their accounts precisely differ on this point. That when Rosa Parks encountered this question, she said, I'm here, I'm sitting in the front of the bus and I won't move. So she brought her no in. And when Adolf Eichmann was asked, are you responsible for that of all the people in the concentration camps, he said, no, I was just following orders. There is no I here in the picture. So all the chapters are connected. And you can see this existential question coming back again and again. In chapter 5, I talk about the gifts of teaching, and I cannot hide, this is probably the most philosophical chapter, because it deals with the idea of givenness. And I use philosophical literature that tries to say, actually, this idea that things are given rather than taken or constructed or invented, that idea has sort of disappeared in modern thinking. And some people say that it's because it's often seen as a religious notion. Revelation is this idea that things are basically given to us. But I try to pursue the argument that actually we need to make place for givenness in our lives. Also because that helps us to really understand what teaching is, without having to talk about learning. So in the book before this one, I argue that there is a fundamental difference between learning from someone, which I do, and being taught by someone, which comes to me. So there's a lot of theoretical fun in that chapter, but I also make it very practical by saying, where do we find moments of gift and givenness in education? And then I say there is an important gift in the curriculum, because the curriculum can never just be about what students ask for. You can say the whole point of education is that we give students what they didn't ask for, what they weren't looking for, precisely because they probably didn't even know that they could ask for it. So there is a gift dimension in education. There was also a line of what in continental theory is called didactics, the idea that all good teaching actually is double truth giving, but I'll skip that for the moment. And then I say the biggest gift that can happen in education is actually that you are being given yourself. And I write more about that, and it comes back again to the existential sort of central line in education. In chapter 6, in a sense, I continue many of these lines, and I do that by discussing the work of a German scholar whose work I have been collecting for a long time and finally managed to bring that together, Klaus Brange, who unfortunately died before I could ever meet him. And he does something really interesting in this discussion around the instrumentalization of education, because he said, how can we secure and safeguard the integrity of education? He says, many people try that by focusing on the right agenda for education. So they say education has to be about freedom or about social justice or about equality. Prange says, well, even with all these brilliant and defensible agendas, there is still the risk that education ends up as an instrument for those agendas. And what he does in his work is saying, actually, the integrity is not in the agenda, but we can find it in the form of education. So he explores a lot about the unique and distinctive form of education. And one point he makes is that he says, the basic form of all education, and we're doing it right now, is in German called zeigen, which partly means pointing and partly means showing. And he says, teaching is actually nothing more, but also nothing less than trying to direct or redirect someone else's attention. And in that simple gesture, we do two things at the same time, because we point at something and we point it out, you could say, to someone. And in that gesture, you can say, we call a student in their unique subjectness to attend to the world. And what I like, if you can still follow what I'm trying to do, is that in this gesture, you can find both the world-centeredness of education, but also the fact that we concern about the students as subjects themselves. Prange makes also a lot by saying, we can not control what the students that we call to attend to the world will do with that. And he also says we shouldn't try to bring that under control, because if we bring it under total control, then suddenly the student is no longer there as subject. And he says, therefore, in the very form of education, we can find an interest in the freedom, he says, or the subjectness of the student. And that's not the freedom to do just what you want to do, but you can say the freedom to come into a relationship with this world that puts limitations on us. And then I end with chapter 7, world-centered education, and then I'm always almost there with the book. So it is probably a thin book and there's not too much in it. You can say when education then is about trying to redirect the attention of our students to the world, and this sounds very big, but it's also very concrete. There are sort of two options for the student when they meet the world there. One option is to say the relationship goes from me to the world. And again, this is very prominent in contemporary education, where we say to our students, you have to come to your own understanding, to your own sense making. We can support that. People sometimes say to your own construction of knowledge. And of course, this is part of the educational reality, where I, the student, some people might say the learner, is in the center. And the main thing I try to do in that last chapter is to say, don't forget that there is a second option that goes exactly in the opposite direction, from the world to me, and where you can say a very different question emerges, not the question, how can I understand, make sense, and so on, but what is this situation, this world asking for me? And for me, that is the far more fruitful educational question, actually, that I also keep coming back in my own teaching. You can say that question doesn't put me or the student in the center. It puts me in the spotlight. It makes clear that it matters that I am there and that there may be something to do for me. What it puts in the center is the world, the natural world, the social world. And you can say with this question, I am being pulled in the direction of the world. And for me, that's the educational gesture. That's in the book. I still needed 60,000 words for that, but I also play with two lovely quotes from Bertolt Brecht, who I was reading a lot about when I was working on the book. This one is nice. The modern theatre mustn't be judged by its success in satisfying the audience's habits. And of course, if you take out the word theatre and put school there, it still makes sense. But by its success in transforming them, it needs to be questioned not about whether it manages to interest the spectator in buying a ticket. So it's not that students should become interested in the school itself, but about whether it manages to interest him in the world. So that's a lovely quote. And then the other one I also like, every teacher must learn how to stop teaching when the time comes. And of course, an interesting judgment is when does this time come for each of us as teacher, educator, parent. That's a difficult art. And Brecht says only a few are able, when the time is right, to allow reality to take their place. And I find this brilliant because, again, it points to the fact that ultimately it's for all of us to step into this world and encounter the reality of that world. And as educators, we can be a bridge there and encourage and equip. But at some point, we have to step back. We have to write our last book and then let others take over. So that's the book in a fast, short version. So that's what I wanted to give you a sense of. And you can either say, okay, I can tick off this book, or you can say, oh, I'd like to read more.
Thank you so much, Gert. That was certainly a very comprehensive overview. I do have a copy here. I've got blurry background. And I can attest to the fact that the font is very small. I thought it was my eyesight, so it's good to know. I think we do have some time now. We'll start with our invited questions and then we'll see how we go. If you do have a question or you'd like to ask one, can you just pop it in the chat? And after we've gone through, after Sam, Alison and Rob, we might have some time, but we'll just see how long Gert's answers are. So if we can start with Sam.
Sure. Hi Gert. Thank you for that wonderful synopsis of the arguments that you elaborate in the book. And thanks, Jenny, for the opportunity to ask one of these invited questions. I'm not sure if this is going to be a question so much as a comment and an invitation to comment a bit further on one aspect of the argument that you've just outlined for us. For some time now, I've been quite interested in Klaus Mollenhauer's work on pedagogy. And I've been thinking about how the pedagogical logic that he outlines entails a normativity and a certain kind of optimism. It's about passing down what's best from our generation to the next generation. And I've been thinking about how crises in the world, ecological crises, for example, place pressure on that logic. You know, what does pedagogy look like if we know that we can't make things better for the next generation because of certain changes in the world for that generation? And so I'm really intrigued by your notion of a world-centered education and where you kind of took us towards the end there about, I guess, the shift towards asking what does the world need from me rather than what kind of subject do I need to become to make the world better, which seems to me the kind of question that Mollenhauer's thinking would encourage us to ask, whereas you're asking a different question, which seems more timely to my mind and perhaps enables us to better respond as educators to the kinds of crises within the world that the next generation will confront. So I guess, like, as I said, it's not so much a question, but just a comment and an invitation to say a little bit more about those issues.
Yeah, believe it or not, but that Mollenhauer book is on my desk. I have some empty shelves in the back. I did something really nice, clearing out my books and looking at each book and saying, so is this book still important? I ended up with about two shelves with the really important books that I still want to do something with or that still need something from me. I think what's interesting about Mollenhauer, and I think it's a beautiful book and a really important one also to read. The book was written in the late 80s. And I think Mollenhauer was responding to, I think, still a trend to make education too much child-centered or student-centered. And he actually starts with the very extreme example of people in Berlin who said education itself is an oppressive structure, and the only way to get rid of the oppression is to get rid of education itself. So they said we don't send our children to school. But of course, this question, what shall we do with the children, is also a very practical one, because if you need to cook or need to earn money, you need to get rid of your children for at least some time. And we know that that's part of what the school does as well. But since these people didn't want education, they called themselves anti-education movement, they put their children in what they called children's shops. And it's, of course, very ironic that they called them shops, Kinderladen. And then they said, we shouldn't constrain children and just let them free and do what they want. And it just became horrible. And so Mollenhauer says, that's the utter educational irresponsibility. If you just say everything comes from the child, then it will be wonderful. So Mollenhauer intervenes in that and says, there is a responsibility for us as educators. And part of this responsibility is not just to innovate, but also to conserve, to look at everything that we have achieved as human beings, and to give the new generation access to that as well. The good things and also the bad things. And I think that that's an important thing not to forget. Hannah Arendt also says, if we don't want to take responsibility for this world that we are part of, which has beautiful things but also horrible things, and if we don't take responsibility for the whole picture, then we shouldn't be educators. So we have to be in that position between the generations as well. And I think that's an important contribution that Mollenhauer makes. Although if you go further on in this book, he also begins to go to this question of how can we encourage children to become subject of their own lives and not walk away from that. So German scholarship has quite a lot to offer, and it's still unfortunate that there is, I think, a language barrier between the English-speaking world and that work. Not that everything is happy and brilliant in Germany, but thanks for making that connection.
Thanks, Gert. You're on mute, Jenny.
I said, is that all, Sam? Are we? Yep. Okay, Alison.
Thank you, Jenny, and thank you, Gert, again for such a succinct overview of your book and raising some thought-provoking ideas. My question is around initial teacher education, and I'm really fascinated by the, what is the world asking of initial teacher education in times when we see the instrumentalisation and tying firmly the relationship between initial teacher education
see this.
The economy. So in a time when the world is framed by ecological, democratic, and ecological, and I'm going to say health crises, what do you see is pivotal to practices of teacher education and the integrity of teacher education that can be generative of a different kind of relationships than beyond the economy?
It's a good question. It's a big one. But that's also good. So I think in education, we encounter really big questions. And of course, we need to figure out what is within our remit and what goes beyond it. Probably today, the answer I would give, which is slightly different from what I've said in the past. So I've spent quite a lot of time arguing that we need to have a broader sense of the purposes of education and not say it's just qualification or not it's just preparation for the work life. It's also socialization to help the new generation to step into cultures and practices and become able to navigate them. And it's this question of subjectification. So for a long time, I've countered this problem of the narrowing of education by saying we need a broader agenda. And I would say in teacher education, yeah, we need to work with our students to see that this education has this broad remit. I think that's really important. But oddly enough, I have lived in Scotland for a pretty long time, 15 years, and have worked at different places in Scotland. And you can say at one level, Scottish education policy gets this and makes it into policy. And then you could say, so I should be very happy because it has landed at the level of policy, and policy is important. But what I now see is that something like social justice just becomes the other thing that needs to be delivered. And the thinking is almost identical to when people say, yeah, we need to deliver literacy, or we need to deliver numeracy or high student test scores. And that, I think, worries me a little, which is one reason why in this book I go back to the integrity of education and say, be careful that if we just put another agenda on education, but forget what is unique about this practice of education, where you can say education is not medicine, it's not therapy, it's not social work. These are different practices that have different forms and a different integrity. So I would say in the whole question of teacher education, I would also work very much on, do we really understand what is unique about our practice and what comes out of that? And what that then means for all the agendas, the problematic and narrow ones, and the ones that look attractive and beautiful, but that are still agendas. And before we know it, makes us as educators forget that there is something in education itself. And some agendas, of course, fit better with that. But in that sense, I'm a bit more critical when people say schools have to work for social justice or for environmental justice, because before you know it, you're just back in the same thing. Just as PISA is now saying, we should not just measure test scores in mathematics and language and science. We should also measure student well-being. And then I say, no, wait a minute, because if you just have the same measurement logic on well-being, you don't understand what the real existential question there is. So for me, these are important questions in teacher education. And for me, it always comes back to saying, but what are we as educators ourselves? What's the integrity of our practice? And what then does that mean? What does that ask from us as educators?
There's a couple of questions here, Gert, and I think we've just got a couple of minutes and then we'll get Rob to finish off. There's one from Nick from Belgium, and he's asking, I often find there's a disconnect between the professional and personal knowledge, beliefs and values, and the purpose of educators. What is your view on the subjectification of educators?
I'll do it quickly, but Nick, if you want to come back to that. So the reason I like the word subjectification, and this is a philosophical insight from Hannah Arendt, who also uses this word subject. And she points to the double meaning of that word, because she says subject partly means to be the origin of something, the origin of action. The subject in a sentence is the one that does the action. But she says subject also has the echo of being subjected. Now, for me, this is a beautiful way to really get closer to what it means to exist as subject, because that is not just about all the things that we want. Of course, we want things, and that energy and that initiative is really important. But for that to become real, it has to meet the world. And the world puts limitations on what we want. So you can say to really exist as subject is not just to be a force of initiative, but also to allow yourself to be subjected to what you meet there and begin to get into a relationship with that. That's why I keep coming back to this word subject and subjectification. And some people say it's too much subjection. And of course, if it's too much subjection, that's not good. Others say it's too much agency. And again, for me, it's to keep these two together. And you could say the ecological crisis is because we have only thought about what we want and not about the limitations that the planet puts upon us. But that's how I want to take up the question. But then, Nick, maybe you want to say what else is there in the question. So I do acknowledge that in order to be a teacher and to stay a teacher throughout your career, a lot of teachers don't manage that, but other teachers, they manage 40 years, 45 years. It's not just about your own energy and your own beliefs, but it's also to, yeah, how shall I put it without sounding too dark, you are also serving education. So it's again there, I think professional subjectification is to establish a connection between your own ambitions, beliefs, aspirations, and what the practice or the profession you step into asks from you. And these two have to come together, because if you say, I'll just erase everything I want and I'll become a total servant of the profession, that's really dangerous and I probably won't sustain. But if you just say it's all about me and I'll change education radically, then you are also not in that profession. So for me, this is an important process, I think, in teacher education to bring these two together in something that can sustain your professionality.
Thanks, Gert. And the next, before we go to Rob, just this next one, where have you come across schools or teachers that have already practiced from the world-centered perspective that you advocate? And could you describe an educational practice that exemplifies this? Thanks, Beth.
What shall I say? As an educator, I'm an optimist. So I think that there is an awful lot of good happening. And I probably would say that if education hasn't got a world-centered element, then probably it cannot sustain itself. So in that sense, I would probably say, I guess that there is quite a lot of this that is still taking place. At the same time, I would say it's not part of the dominant discourse about education. So the way we talk about education tends not to emphasize this. I find that a strange disjunction that also isn't helping teachers. So for me, it's really important to keep working on the language as well, so that we can better talk about what's happening in front of our eyes. And I never want people to implement my work. The only thing that I really like is when people say you give words to what we are sort of thinking that we're doing, but for which we we no longer have the words or didn't have the words, then I think something significant is happening. As soon as you begin to name things, you begin to single out particular approaches. I've drawn a lot of inspiration from Steiner education, which I think in its forms of practice gets quite a lot of this relationship between child and world. I often use gardening as an important example of world-centered education, because what's interesting about a garden or a plant is that you can think as hard and as long as you want about the plant, but that won't make the plant grow any faster or better. The encounter with the plant is precisely an encounter with something that asks something from you. And therefore you can say to have gardening on the curriculum is not in order to learn physics in an experiential way, but precisely to meet a reality that is immune for your thinking, but doesn't appeal to you. And it's beautiful and very simple that a plant does that, or an animal does that. And of course, you can also say another human being does that as well. We don't need other human beings to think about them, and definitely not to think for them. But you can say in that encounter, there is the same appeal. And if you begin in a curriculum by letting children encounter that with plants, and then maybe with animals, where there's a bit more at stake, but then also see that a classroom is a social organism that also puts the question back to the students, you suddenly begin to see the world-centeredness in the everyday practice. So that's where I would go with that.
Thanks a lot, Gert. And thanks for the other comments there. People have just said that's a lovely idea and so forth. We're coming near to the end of our time, so if people want to just read the comments themselves, that would be great. Rob.
Yeah, so hi, Gert. Thanks very much for joining us again. Probably given we've got 2 minutes left, I'll just sort of end things off, actually, and perhaps maybe we could do it this way. One of the things that I really appreciate in my academic life is sort of academic generosity. And I think Gert sort of demonstrates two types of generosity, actually, that I just want to comment on at this point. So practically, Gert's been incredibly generous with his time and his mind and thoughts in the last few years with his engagement with academics at the University of South Australia. And I could make a big long list, actually, of all the things that we've done together, and perhaps just to sort of mention a couple which are pertinent at this point. Gert did become an adjunct with our university, which we appreciate immensely, and as a consequence of that, we've been generating a sort of what we hope is a long-term conversation between our research centre and the research centre at Maynooth, which is already turning out to be very, very productive. Meantime, Gert's got a relationship with the two principals associations in our state, and so is doing important sort of work there, which is hopefully about to manifest into a properly sort of funded research fellowship with Gert and all of us. So thank you very much for all of that. And he's come to Adelaide a few times and been a part of some of our workshops, and we're hoping when we can all fly again, we can do that also. But the other sort of generosity I wanted to mention is the way that Gert puts out his critique is not sort of a one size fits all, here's the answer, but it's more sort of a provocation to thought, actually. So the very sort of generation of his critique has a generosity that comes with the way that even at the level of the grammar. And I suppose from my own side, whenever I engage with Gert, I just enjoy the sort of pleasure of the generosity and the demand to think really hard again about, you know, what my life's about. And so it's sort of a provocation to thought. So thank you very much for that. And he demonstrated it just a few minutes ago, because he refuses to tell us what we should do on the basis of his provocations, and leaves that up to us. And constantly resisting strong normative positions, which sort of frustrates a lot of people. But I think I get the project there. But perhaps just to sort of leave off this, to end this way, I too was interested in where you think this is manifesting in practice. And I think that's a conversation we can continue. I'm sort of provoked to, given that I've read your other little books, if we can use that language, what's the sort of new thing, how's this one sort of ending off? It started as a trilogy, didn't it? I think it's now up to five. So that's going to be interesting work for some of us to do. But maybe last comment, just recently, for various reasons, I went back and reread Bruno Latour's a very provocative essay on that was, I forget the exact title, but he had a thought experiment where he was trying out that he thought critique had run out of steam. As someone who sort of spent 30 years trying to sort of engage in critique, it's of course an offensive title, and I wanted to resist it as strongly as I could, and I still do. And I think in the end he tries to retrieve critique as well, and your work demonstrates that. But in the middle of that piece, and there's been some small secondary literatures around this one, he proposes giving up on matters of fact and taking up matters of concern as a sort of driving way to sort of think about critique. And I think what you've provided here is sort of an example of how we might think about shifting from matters of fact to matters of concern, right, to drive our sort of diagnosis and how we might sort of live as educators. And I don't know whether you wanted to respond to that in 30 seconds, but
Thanks very much. Thanks for your kind words. I have to say, I also get into trouble with my generosity, so my big frustration is not being able to respond to all the emails I get. So if anyone in the audience is waiting for a response, that's the challenge. Matters of fact, matters of concern. Yes, the world-centeredness also means that the question of what is real becomes, I think, a really important question. And that's a different question from the question, what is true? And maybe in our political times, we can see that with the question of truth, we are not managing it, because that can go in any direction. And we probably have to thank Immanuel Kant and the social constructivists for creating the opportunity for that disaster. But reality poses a different challenge to us. And there you can say, reality is always a concern. And the question when we meet reality is not what is true about this, but it's the question, so what is this asking from us? And the big sort of disasters, I think Donald Trump has never encountered that question in his life, because he has never encountered reality in his life. He lives in a fantasy. And you can say that the real task for us as educators is to help those children who need it, but not all children need it, but also to help ourselves to stay awake for what is real. And of course, we also have created an economy that is constantly selling us fantasies, the fantasy of quick fixes, for example, or the fantasy of total happiness. And all of that distracts us from staying in touch with the real. And for me, that you can say is the main concern for education. If we cannot help the new generation and ourselves to stay with the real, then I'm happy to close the schools and hand learning over to Google and Apple. But I'm not yet willing to give up on that. So that's probably the last word, and it opens up more discussions. But I just want to say thank you all for being here, and thanks very much for making this possible. It's quite fantastic what this strange online world can actually do in connecting so many people in so many places. So I'll stop here.
Thank you so much, Gert. We really appreciate the time that you've given us. I know you had to get up a little bit early. And people have joined us from all around the world at different, I know some people are in their classrooms in schools and other people are getting their dinner. So thank you so much for your time. Thanks to Sam, Alison and Rob, but also to other people who've made comments and questions. Also thank you to Anna, Anna Sullivan, who you might be able to see on your screen, who is the director of CRESI, the Centre for Research in Education and Social Inclusion at the University of South Australia. There is a YouTube channel at CRESI, and the video of this presentation will be uploaded to that. How's that available, Anna?
You'll all be emailed. Yeah, we'll send you
an email. Thank you. So you'll be let know when that's available. So we really do thank you for joining us, and hopefully that you'll be able to enjoy some other events that hopefully we might be able to have in the future in these strange times when it seems this is the only way that we can get together. So again, thank you, and good evening, good morning, good afternoon, wherever you happen to be.
Thank you.